This conference will now be recorded.
Hello. Hi, Siri. Hello. Hi, Siri.
Hello.
Hi. So, shall we start?
Yeah, I'm ready.
Let me know once you can see my screen.
Yeah, I'm able to see.
Okay. So, today we'll start our session with bootstrapping. In the last session, we have seen how to create a EC2 instance, correct? Have you tried that?
We just saw the theory session of EC2.
We didn't saw the lab session?
No. Actually,
you missed that session, right? Okay. So
yeah, you sent me the video, I think. I think we are okay with that. We can continue with the session.
We can move forward, correct?
Yes, we can move
on. You want me to show you once again about the EC2 section?
No, it's fine. You can you send me the video already, so I'm good with it. Yeah, we can just go ahead and have the bootstrap.
Okay, so I'm in my AWS console, and again, we need to select a region in which you want to create an infrastructure. So this is very important. And you can just select here EC2, or you can directly go ahead with EC2 here. Now, bootstrapping is a script that you will run while creating your EC2 instance, so that whenever your EC2 instance comes up, it will have all the packages, all the commands that you want to run. It will be pre-install everything. So to do that, just click on launch instance and select the AMI which you want to go. Let's go with, again, simple Linux AMI. Instance type T2 micro. And now, keeping all the things default, here you can write a script. Now, as this is our Linux instance, so we will write here bash script. So bash script always starts with a shebang. Bash. Bin bash. So this is a thing that's called shebang. Hashtag exclamatory comma slash bin slash bash. This is called shebang. Now, whatever the command you want to put, you can. Let's call yum install httpd hyphen y. Http is a package name for Apache. So it will download the Apache. Then let's start the service, httpd service httpd start. It will start the server. Now, there is a one command, chk config httpd on. Now this is command, what it will do, it will do some configuration in the Apache server, which will tell the Apache server if a server restart, that is, if your EC2 instance restart, then it should always start the Apache server, similar to your local machine. If you restart your local machine, all the system running your machine will be closed, correct? In a similar way, when you terminate or when you stop the EC2 instance, all the running application running inside your EC2 instance are also get stopped. So this configuration will make an auto start application whenever you manually reboot the machine. Okay. Now we'll write a script. We will design a page. Let's call H1. Hi, this is web server. This is a simple HTML document that we will create, and we will move it into var www.html/index.html. Now, do you know what exactly this is? The path we have already seen in the EC2 part. what is this doc path?
There's a path we give to get the page, right?
Yeah, exactly. So where WWHTML is a public folder. Whatever the data you dump here, all will be shown on the website. All will be shown on your server. So this is a path where you will dump all your web application, all your website, or any kind of data that you want to showcase on Apache server, that is on your web server. Okay. So this is a file that we are creating. Hi, this is web server one. That's it. So I will just copy and I'm just pasting this on the chat so that you can have also a copy of that. Then add storage, we'll keep everything default, tags, let's call it name, server one, configure security group, we have, I guess, a security group, yes, 80 and 22 port is open for the world, so review and launch. Let's just create a new key pair. Okay, and launch instance. Which operating system you are using?
Windows.
So do you know how to connect with Windows EC2 machine with Windows via using
I have seen that. Like I've installed Cygwin and I'm doing that.
Okay, great. Let me know if you have any kind of problem with that.
Sure.
So, our server is currently running same, but it will take few seconds more to run our application. So you can test it here. You can just copy this thing and paste in the browser. It's still not connecting. Okay, now you can see, hi, this is web server one. I am posting the same IP address here on the chat. You can also try on your browser. You will also get the same.
Okay.
Now, just imagine a scenario like you have a domain, example.com or whatever the .com you have. Okay, you have purchased a domain and you have a web server. Now, how will you map this both the things? So whatever the IP address you get here or this public DNS, this is a public DNS. So whatever in both of the case, you need to just copy this and in the Route 53 section, you need to just map your domain with this IP address. Or if you have running outside this AWS, if you have purchased any domain outside this AWS, then you need to just forward that URL to this domain, to this DNS part. So in this way, whenever you hit to your website, to your domain, you will be, redirected to this IP addresses, so that whatever the data you want to show, that will be shown here. So in this way, a web server works how you map with your domain. So we have created just one server.
Can you repeat again? How will you map it? Can you just repeat the part? Sorry.
Yeah, sure. It's just theoretical. We will look into practically in the Route 53 section. But for example, you have created a domain. Let's say. aws.com. okay, in your AWS you have purchased this kind of domain aws.com in Amazon Web Services. Now you want to just, whenever you create a domain in AWS, you get one hosted zone. A hosted zone is nothing but a container in which you can create a record set, and the record set, you can say whenever this IP address, whenever this this domain name is hit on the website, on the browser, it should redirect to this IP address.
Okay.
This is your public IP address or this is your DNS. So you can map it to any of these services. So what will happen? Whenever you hit to aws.com, it will be shown the web page which is present on this domain. So in this way, your domain will be mapped with your web server. Okay.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks.
Yeah. So I have one server ready. And this is how we do bootstrapping. Now we will launch one more server with the same thing. Configure and in the advanced setting, again the same script. And here I'm just saying this is web server 2. Add storage, add tags, simply same name, server 2. Okay. keeping all the things default. Again, the same security code with 80 and 22 port open and launch. Now, whenever this server will start automatically, it should reflect that, hi, this is web server 2. Now, in case if you want to change the user data, so what you need to do, as we have done it, our first server is running, so we need to stop this server. Once you have stopped this server, in the instance setting, there is the option of change user data. So you can modify your user data here, but it will not reflect to your current infrastructure. Whatever the current EC2 instance you have created, it will not reflect to that. If you do any kind of changes and then you create an AMI, then that part will be reflected in that AMI. But that part is not reflected here, because Bootstrap is a thing that is always run whenever you are just booting up your machine. It's not when you restart the machine, it will not affect when you restart the machine or start the machine. It will always be applicable whenever you are booting the machine. That's why it's called bootstrapping. Okay, so our instance 2 is also running. Let's copy. It will take some time. Okay, so our server 1 and server 2 are ready. So meantime, what we will do, we'll look into EBS, that is volume section. So in the volume, now this EC2 1 server 1 has 8 GB of volume, right? During the creation of EC2 instance, we have just used the default thing. And here you can see the root device is SVDA. And the same device is blog device, which is which device is used for the same booting of your machine. Similarly, for the server 2 also, the configuration is same. We have only one boot device, which is 8 GB. Now what we'll do, we'll create one more 10 GB of data, 10 GB of volume. That volume will be an EBS volume, which we will attach first to server 1. We will include some data, we will add some data in using the server 1. And then we will detach and attach it to server 2. As EBS is a persistent storage system, so whatever the transition we will do from one server to another server, our data should persist. Am I correct?
Yes.
Yeah. So same thing, we will look into how to do that. So let's go to the EBS volume, that is volume section. And you can see the server 1 is 8 GB, server 2 is 8 GB, which is currently in use. Now, to create a volume, just simply you need to create a volume, and here you can specify amount of GB you want to use, that is minimum 1 GB to maximum 16 TB. And you can also choose the different types of volume type which you want to use, general purpose, provision, IOPS. This both can be used for booting up your machine also, and these are just a hard disk type which cannot be used for booting up your volume machine. So I will go with the 10 GB. Now, one important point that you need to remember, the availability zone. The availability zone of the EBS and the EC2 machine should be same. It's not like, it's not region specific, it's a availability zone specific. So if your EC2 instance is in 1A, then your EC2 instance, then your EBS volume must also be in 1A. So let's see where we have created this EC2 instance. Okay, so here you can see both are in 1A. So again, we will create the same in the 1A zone and 1A. If you have already existed any snapshot, that is already you have created a copy of your data, then if you want to make a copy of, if you want to replicate that copy of volume, you can just select the snapshot ID. This is a public snapshot ID. If you don't have any, you can just keep it blank. If you want to encrypt this volume, we can encrypt it and tags for entering the tags. Okay. Additional volume. Create volume. Okay. Our 10 GB volume is being created. Additional volume of 10 GB. And here the current status is available. So what we'll do, we'll just click on action and click on attach volume. Now when you click on EC2 instance, it will show you what are the EC2 instances that you are running currently in your system. So here you can just simply select which EC2 instance you want to attach. So I will go with the server one and click on attach. So the status has now become in use, which means now we can connect easily. So I will just copy this IP address and open my terminal. CD download, and I need to first chmod a key that is Mumbai keypair.txt. Now SSH hyphen I key EC2 hyphen user at the direct public IP. Yes, connect. Now, first thing to check whether that EBS volume is connected, is attached to your EC2 instance or not. This command is lsblk. Okay, using this command, you can check whether that EBS volume has been connected to your volume or not. So you can see the first volume is 8 GB of volume, which is XVDA. And the second volume that is attached is SVDF, which says 10 GB of data, right? Here you can see this 10 GB. So which means our data has been successfully connected. Now let's connect to one more machine. SSH -i Mumbai EC2 -. And now I will connect to my second machine on which we haven't attached our EBS volume. So let's see how it looks. Let's PLK. Now here you can see there is only 8 GB of data available. There is no 10 GB of data attached. So in our first EC2 machine, what we'll do, we'll make a file system, because this is a completely new volume. So we need to format this volume. We need to tell which kind of file type it should support. So as this is a Linux operating system, so we will create a EST4 based file system. So file, make file system hyphen t ext4 and slash dev slash xvdf. So make mkfs is make file system hyphen t, define what kind of file format you want. That is, I want ext4. Yeah, we have multiple types of file format: ext4, fat32, fat128, fat16. Then for Windows we have nfs. Like, do you know all these file formats?
No, but it's okay. I will learn them later.
Basically in your Windows computer, if you just click on any of the volumes, or if you just attach a pen drive and if you click on format, then you will get this kind of option. There also you can see this kind of options.
Okay.
And then you need to select which drive you want. So I want a drive from dev svdf. So dev is a common directory that you need to mention, and which kind of, this is xvdf I want to attach. So just click on it and it's just doing that. So it says done, which means our file system has been created. Now we'll make a one directory. Let's call test. Okay, a test has been created. Now we will mount this test directory to our volume. So mount slash dev slash svdf and slash test. Now if I do lsplk, you can see here a mount point has been created at test. So if I go now at test, here I can see I have nothing included in my 10 GB volume. Here I can create a file text dot, let's say txt. And I can write and see this. Okay, you can see there is a test file in our test folder. Okay, which means our data has been successfully written in our file. Okay, and on the 10 GB of volume, we have one file called test.txt. Now I will just move out of this text.txt file and unmount this file. The command is umount hyphen d slash dev slash awsdf. Now if I try to lsblk again, it says that the mount position has been removed. We don't have any mount position, but still the 10 GPL data is attached. Just imagine now, map it with your real-time scenario. You attach a pen drive to your Windows machine. Once you have attached a volume, you see on the Windows Explorer that the 10 GPL volume has been attached. Okay. Now when I try to mount that file, which means like you are trying to format that file, format that for pen drive. Okay. Whatever the thing you want to do, whatever the images, whatever the text file you want to move to the your pen drive, you did it. That's what we did in vi text.txt. We have created one file and moved to our text folder. That is our volume. Now the second command I've sent is umount /t/svdf, which means like if you map it with your Windows computer, then you reject. Always whenever you try to pull out the pen drive, you need to first eject that volume. So the same thing I did, I have just ejected that volume from my EC2 instance. And then if I can see, if I just go back to my volume section, now what I can do, I can just click on action and detach volume.
Okay.
So we need to wait for a certain seconds till it becomes available. It is now available. Now if I try to lsblk, it will not show me 10 GB of volume. Okay. Now what you can do, you can just attach it back to our second server, that is server 2, and attach. Now you want to tell me, we have already created a file system, which means our volume is already formatted. Now when I want to attach it to another EC2 instance, do I need to do the same process again?
You mean the mounting?
Yeah, everything, every command that we have sent in this EC2 instance, do we need to do the same part in the second EC2 instance?
Yeah, because it's a different instance, I think we need to do the same thing.
No. For instance, okay, we need to mount and unmount the thing, but the making of file system is not necessary. Just imagine you have attached a pen drive in your computer. You have inserted some data, some 1 GB of data you have inserted. Now, if you are moving this pen drive to another computer, will you format it again?
No.
No, that's fine. We don't need to create another, once again, the file system. The file system has been already created. We just need to mount that directory in our second EC2 instance. Okay. So we have successfully attached to this second EC2 server. So if I try to do lsblk, now you can see the 10 GB volume is being attached, but we don't have any mount point. So what we'll do, we will create a mount point. To create a mount point, we need to first create a directory. Let's call this time wall. Okay. Now we'll mount wall to this folder. So /dev/svdf/wall. Now if I do lsblk, you can see here the wall volume has been mounted to this 10 GB of volume. Now you can just go to the volume directory and see what is the data available. And here you can see the test.txt data is present. If I do cat, and you can see the message is written, this is test file, which we have created in our EC2 instance 1, correct?
Yeah.
So few things here need to remember. You can attach and detach EC2 instance. You can attach and detach an EBS volume once at a time. Okay. You can attach an EBS volume to a single EC2 instance at a time. A single EC2 instance can have multiple EBS volume, but an EBS volume at a time will be attached to a single EC2 instance. Did you get the difference? This is very important.
That in theory class itself.
Okay, great. The second thing is both the EC2 instance and both the EBS volume must be in the same availability zone, because EBS volume is a physical storage system. So you cannot just connect to another availability zone or another region directly. You need to make a snapshot of that AMI, snapshot of that volume, and then you have option to then send it to another region or another availability zone, and then you can create a volume there. But directly you don't have any option. Now the commands to do that is, first we need to connect to our EC2 machine. Then the command lsblk will show you list all the blocks in your operating system. There is an amount of volumes available. Then what we will do, we will create a make file system, MKFS, and what kind of file system you want to create, you can just mention that EST4, FAT32, FAT16, etc. Then we have created a directive. A directive is an entry point to your operating, to your volume. So we will create a directory. Now this directory name can be different from different operating system. For EC2.1, we have created a test folder. For EC2.2, we have created a vol folder. So this can be changed. This doesn't need to be same. And then we have mounted this part here. Same, if you want to unmount that part, then you need to use a command umount -d /a/svdf. And here also you can do the same. So do you have any doubts in that? In this EBS volume?
No, I'm good.
Do you want to try it right now?
No, I don't want to try right now. I'll try it later, because I'm still configuring little things, so I cannot do it right now.
Okay, but for any relaxation, if you want to do it, in front of me, you can do that. It's not a problem. Okay.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah.
So this is all about EBS and thing. Now, one important point, when you talk as a solution architect, or while giving the exam for the certification, few things you need to remember as a solution architect, that you can attach, you can modify a volume. So for currently, your requirement is just 10 GB of volume, and tomorrow you require, as your data center increases, your data increases, if you want to upgrade that volume, you can do that. So if I have 10 GB, I can make it 11 GB, 12 GB, but I cannot do 9 GB because the size of the volume can only be increased, not decreased. Okay. So this is very important to remember, that EBS volume can only be increased, not decreased. So in such case, what you need to do is, you need to grow horizontally. That is, if you have attached a 10 GB of volume, and if you require another 10 GB of volume, you should create a separate volume of 10 GB volume and attach to that EC2 instance. This is called horizontal scaling. Adding 10 GB plus 10 GB plus 10 GB multiple volume is a good solution. Then 10 GB upgrading the existing 10 GB to 20 and 30 is not a good solution. Because if any moment, if you want to reduce your size, for example, just consider scenario where you currently you are just having a startup, and you want only 10 GB of storage for your production account. Okay, now tomorrow, as your customers are increasing, you think that you need extra 10 GB of data. Again, you have attached, you have modified that existing volume to another 20 GB of volume. In future, again, if you think that you need more storage, you will update this existing storage. Now, at any moment, if you want to come back to your 10 GB of volume, 20 GB of volume, if your business is not running and you are having a high cost, then in such case, you cannot come down. But if you are having multiple volume, you can just crash it off one volume. You can move your data to existing volume and just crash the newly created volume. So in this way, growing horizontally is a very good option than vertical growing. Okay. So this is very important as a solution architect, you need to remember. And whenever you are dealing with AWS project or your client, you need to also tell them the same. Okay.
So we can delete a volume, but we can delete a volume, but we cannot decrease it. That's it, right?
Exactly. So when you have multiple volumes, and if you want to, decrease the volume size, then you can just cut a single volume out of that. But if you are growing vertically, at that time you don't have any kind of options to decrease the volume size.
Okay.
Now click on action, and you have an option to create a snapshot. A snapshot is nothing but a backup copy of this volume. So this 10 GB volume has been will be created a backup copy of another 10 GB, and which is stored on the S3. Once you have created this snapshot, you will find in the snapshot section. Okay, I have already existing one snapshot available. So the process is the same as the same AMI ID. You have owned by me, public snapshot, and private snapshot, which means If you are creating your own custom AMI or own custom snapshot, now this snapshot you can also share with anyone. You can share it with publicly, that is anyone on the internet, anyone on the AWS can use this snapshot. Or if you want to share with another AWS account, then also you can do that. You need to just enter the 12-digit account ID and click on add permission. Now, if someone is sharing with you, then you will find in the private snapshot. And if someone is sharing publicly, you want to share, you want to see how many people are sharing it publicly, you can just click on it. And here you will find n number of people have shared this with different kinds of volume here. 8 GB, 200 GB. Now you can see the description here. If some person has shared 200 GB of volume, etc. You can see if you want to use any of this, you can do that. It says a snapshot of image root part, whatever it is. Okay. So this is all about the ABS EC2 bootstrapping. Any doubt, any questions in it?
No, I'm good.
Okay. So I think our second EC2 instance is still not running. Let me just see what is the issue. Inbound ports are open 80 and 22. And user data. Okay, the shebang server is not copied. The hashtag that shebang server is not here written. That's why it's not creating the HTTP. Okay, so what we'll do, we have already connected to our machine. We'll just do it simply. Okay, service HTTP start chk config HTTP on. Now we will create one file. The file is we'll say this, hi, this is web server 2, so that we can identify which is our server. Now, if I try to refresh the site, it should say this is web server 1. And now if I hit to web server, first IP address, it says this is web server 1. Okay. Now let's see load balancer. Okay, EC2 load balancer. An elastic load balancer automatically distributes incoming application traffic across multiple targets such as EC2. It can be EC2, it can be ECS container, it can be any private IP address. Now, you can also create your own load balancer. There is a service called HAProxy. I'll show you HAProxy. This is high availability proxy relation. So this is the HAProxy. The same technology is used by the Amazon to give you elastic load balancer kind of managed service. But this is something, if you are creating your own, then you need to maintain. For example, you have 4 EC2 instances running for your application server, okay? And then you have created one load balancer, your manual load balancer, with this HAProxy thing. Now this HAProxy will be the front end to all the 4 EC2 instances, which means, like, let's say this is your web server and this is your HAProxy. So whatever the incoming request is coming from the internet, it will be sent to the HAProxy. Now HAProxy will route all this traffic to multiple EC2 instances which is running behind it. Now the difference between manual doing and using Amazon managed services, you need to maintain an EC2 instance for this. You need to install the HAProxy, and then you need to configure all 3 different IP addresses here in this server. This is all thing that you need to maintain. You need to do it manually. But when it comes to Amazon managed services, you don't need to worry about any of this. You don't need to maintain a server. You don't need to manually add these servers to your load balancer. You don't need to worry about any of this thing. The another difference is when your infrastructure is in auto-scaling mode, and due to high spike, if any other new EC2 instances are creating, then the newly EC2 instance you need to manually insert in this Azure proxy. Whereas when you go with the Amazon Manager Elastic Load Balancer, you don't need to again worry about that. It will automatically include that newly created EC2 instance in that load balancer. Okay. So what is the difference between manual creating a load balancer and using Amazon Load Balancer is, first, you need to maintain a server, whereas in AWS, you don't need to maintain a server. If you go with the manual, then you need to install and configure all these things. You need to manually add the description of both all the web server, all the IP addresses. Whereas in Amazon Managed Service, you don't need to do all these things. In auto-scaling mode, if any new EC2 instance is creating, then again, you need to add the description, add the details in your HFProxy. Whereas Amazon Web Services, you don't need to worry about all these things. It will automatically do that. So these are the three differences why you need to go with AWS Managed Services and apart from using the manual service. Another big difference is with the pricing. So the cost of creating a EC2 instance and managing a load balancer in it will cost you more than creating an elastic load balancer. Now, another difference you get is the property elasticity. When you go and create EC2 instance and create a HFProxy, at that time you don't have elasticity. You have just EC2 instance that will grow. That will meet the requirement based on the instance type. If you are creating a T2 micro EC2 instance and you are installing HFProxy, then it will will only grow till that it supports. It will not go beyond its utilization. Whereas in Elastic Load Balancer, it has an auto scaling capacity, so it always meets the requirement. For example, if you have only 10,000 requests per second currently, then it will support 10,000 requests easily. And if any moment, if the spike reaches to 1 lakh, 2 lakh, 10 lakh of requests per second, then it has the capability to meet that requirement. So again, here you don't need to maintain any kind of thing here. You don't need to worry about any of this thing. Okay, did you get the difference? Or should I repeat once again?
No, I'm good with this.
Okay. So, Elastic Load Balancer. Now, ELP act as a single point of contact. Whenever a user hits to an ELP, it will be then reflected to the multiple EC2 instances running behind it. So ELP is a single point of contact for sending a request to multiple EC2 instances. If there are 10 EC2 instances running, then this ELP DNS point will act as a single point of contact. And the job of this ELP is to send traffic to 10 different EC2 instances. Now, just imagine there are 3 incoming requests are coming, or let's say there are 6 incoming requests are coming currently, 6 incoming requests per second, and there is one ELP. And behind this ELP, there are 3 EC2 instances. So what will happen? The first request which came will be sent to the first EC2 instance, second is sent to the second, third is sent to the third. Now the fourth request is sent to the again to the first server, fifth request will be sent to the second server, and sixth request will be sent to the third server. So it will send the request sequentially to the number of EC2 instances it has. If there is only 2 EC2 instances, then it will distribute the traffic equally. Sequentially, it will distribute the traffic in the equal amount of time. So this is done via round robin technique. This is very important to remember that ELB uses round robin technique to distribute the traffic across multiple EC2 instances. So with this, it will send sequence wise and it will distribute the load equally. Again, if there are 5 requests are coming, then if there are 5 EC2 instances running, then it will send one by one to each of the EC2 instances. In the same number of time, if 10 requests are coming, then it will send 2 requests per EC2 instance. But it will be always equal number of requests per send sent to your EC2 instance. Now, this is just an overview architecture, how your web architecture looks like. Let me just give you an overview. This is internet, okay? And from internet, your application requests are coming. like example.com. So whenever the example.com you have hit it, it goes to route 53. So this is route 53. Now this at this route 53, you have configured whatever the requests are coming at example.com domain should move to the ELB. Now as internet requests are coming directly to this ELB, this ELB is called internet facing ELB. Okay. Now whatever the requests are coming to this ELB, this ELB will send the traffic to this EC2 instance and this EC2 instance equally. If three requests are coming, it will send first request to this EC2, second to this, and third to this. It will distribute the traffic equally. Now let's consider a scenario, a three-tier architecture, which means like this is your front end, this is your back end, and this is your database. Do you know the difference between front end, back end, and database? That is three-tier architecture. Okay.
Yeah.
Great. So for example, like Amazon.com, whatever you see on the front end, let's say that all is hosted on this public subnet. Okay. And whenever you try to hit on add to bucket and cart, or whenever you try to do any kind of payment thing, then this request has been sent to via this ELB. Okay. The request has been sent via this security group and to this ELB. Now the job of this ELB to distribute that traffic to these two private subnet. This private subnet will do the private payment things or additional the address part and all those things. Here it will do all the same. So the request coming to this ELB is from another subnet or from another EC2 instance. So this kind of ELB is called internal ELB. Whenever a request is coming from internet is called internet facing ELB, and whenever the application is request is coming from internal architecture is called internal ELB. So it will process the things here, and then the send request will send back to the other one second ELB, which will send the data, which will write the data to your database. This is just a three-tier architecture common scenario how your web application works. The thing that I want to mention is the few points. First is the public ELB, that is internet facing ELB. And second is the internal ELB. So this is the only point that I need to mention here. So the classic load balancer, it increases your fault tolerance. It acts as a single point of contact. So if there are multiple EC2 instances, then you don't need to map all these EC2 instances with your domain. You will add as a single point of contact that ELB, and ELB will send the data to all the EC2 instances. Instances can be added or removed anytime. Now this elastic load balancer has a capability to perform health check. Like if the EC2 instance is healthy, if the server is running and it has a capability to respond, then and then only it will send the traffic to that EC2 instance. For example, there are three EC2 instances running, and out of the three EC2 instances, one of the EC2 instances got down due to high server outage or any kind of thing. The server is not working. So in that case, it will continually check the health of that EC2 instance, and if it encounters that this EC2 instance is not healthy, then it will send a traffic to other remaining two EC2 instances. It will not send traffic to unhealthy EC2 instances. So it always performs health check. Now it can be internal or external that we have just seen. That is external, which is internet facing, and internal load balancer we have already seen just now. And the communication between ELB and instance take place over instance private IP. Now, if you remember in the recorded session, I have told you like the public IP always changes. Whenever you restart the EC2 instance, the public IP changes. Now, yes. In such case, what ELB do is ELB connects to your private instance via private IP. A private IP is something that never changes. So even if your EC2 instance is restarting, will never affect to your ELB, or it will never affect to your domain, because the communication are happening between ELB and private IP of the EC2 instance. Then it has its own security group. Now just understand a scenario like you are running a e-commerce site which requires 80 port to be open, 80 and 443 port to be open. Now this port you can open at ELB section and you can deny on EC2 section. We'll see into this how we can do that. But if you do like this, then any person cannot directly hit to your browser. For example, what we do as of now, we copy the public IP of our EC2 instance, we go to the browser and hit to the browser with that particular IP address, and we see our data. But when you just deny this port to be open for the world and you open at the ELB, so that ELB will be only responsible for any incoming connection. If I just copy the IP address of Amazon.com, if I try to create a separate connection with the server and try to hit the data, I won't be able to using this scenario. So all these things you can maintain in the security group. There is a listener. A listener is a port where you can open multiple ports like 80 port, 443 port, HTTP, HTTPS, TCP, and SSL. These four types of protocols are supported in the listener section. Then load balancer types. So we previously by 2017, we have only one type of load balancer called classic load balancer. We support all the types of load balancer, that is HTTP, HTTPS, and other types of load balancing. It supports all type of thing. But as for increasing demand and due to its limitation, they have created two more load balancer called as application load balancer and network load balancer. Now, the difference between application, network, and classic are both of these load balancer can support millions of requests per second. It can handle millions of requests per second, whereas classic load balancer still does not support that much limitation. It has that one limitation that it cannot support millions of requests, but application network can support millions of requests. Now, do you know OSI model in network architecture? You must have studied in the school time, college time.
Which model?
OSI model.
No, what is it? OSI, yeah.
Yeah, OSI. It's a network model which defines how your packet is sent to you and delivered to your recipient. Okay, so there are seven layers in the OSI model. Network layer, data link layer, application layer, and I know that you have studied in the scholar section. Yeah. So the last layer is application layer. So this application load balancer act at the application layer, which support HTTP and HTTPS request only, which means if you want to showcase anything on the browser at 80 port or 443 port, then for such kind of thing, only application load balancer is useful. Whereas in network load balancer act as a third and fourth layer of OSI model, between network and data link layer. This support TCP workload, for example, gaming website. Now we play games on mobile phone, correct? Now on the mobile phone, we use an application to play the game. We don't open the port, we don't open the website to play the games, correct? We play a game at specific port. Maybe it's 443, 993, etc., whatever the port is. So we interact with the server, that application talks to the server at certain port. But that port is not HTTP or HTTPS because we do not play on browser. We play on an application which is internally connected to a server. So this kind of communication you can do via network load balancer. You can enter any kind of TCP port and you can have communication with your server. All the mobile application works on a TCP model. All the mobile application work on an internal port of any server. So this kind of things you can develop on network load balancer. So that's why they have separated two things, application load balancer and network load balancer. Now another difference is application load balancer can perform health check. As its name says, application. So whatever the application you have hosted on your browser, on your server, you can just give the path of that application and it will continuously check the whether that application is running or not. Whereas network load balancer doesn't support such kind of, it will only check whether that site is, whether that DNS endpoint is available or not. It will do that much only. So to perform a health check, the terms are, first you will require to enter the protocol, that is whether it is HTTP, HTTPS, what kind of protocol it is. Then response timeout, that is time to live after n number of seconds. If we didn't receive any kind of response from the server, then it should be considered as unhealthy or whatever the thing is. So time to live. then port. So do you know how domain works? What is the format of domain? The format of a domain is like www://then domain.com, correct? Now,
yep.
First, the string is protocol, that is HTTP, HTTPS. So we need to tell the load balancer what kind of protocol you are using. So here we need to specify HTTP or HTTPS. Second, we need to also say, well, if it is HTTPS, then we need to say that this is a port 80. If it is HTTPS, we need to say this is 443. So you need to define the port also where the browser will check. Then it comes to your path, that is domain and domain/path.
Yep.
So that can be done via health check interval. So health check interval is something that after n number of seconds, after what number of seconds you want to perform the health check. Let's say I have given 5 seconds. So what it will do, after every 5 seconds, it will perform the health check. So health check interval. Ping path, define what kind of path you want to enter, protocol, port, and then path. That is https://80port. And domain.com/index.html. I can define all this thing here. The last term is healthy threshold, which is like if I said healthy threshold is 2. So what it will do, it will trigger a health check. And if the health check is positive, that is whatever the path I have given index.html, if that is responsive, then it will mark as a healthy. Again, after the n number of seconds, that is health check interval, it will perform the health check. Again, if I get the pass certificate that my EC2 instance is running perfectly, with this two consecutive running pass certificate, this can be considered as a healthy. This EC2 will be considered as healthy. So here you need to define how many consecutive checklists you want to maintain to say whether that EC2 instance is healthy or not. Similarly, unhealthy threshold. Number of consecutive failed health check. If you have say 3 failed health check, then if any kind of EC2 instance failed to perform health check for the next 3 times, then it will be considered as unhealthy. So using this term, you can define your health check. Okay.
Okay.
So this is just a visual of how it works. There is a one VPC, there is subnet. You can just imagine. And there are 4 EC2 instances running in 2 subnets. Now this is an ELB. So if a person is trying to hit to the browser, if a request is coming to the browser, it will be sent to the ELB. Now the ELB is responsible for sending the data to the EC2 instance. So first it will send to EC2 1, instance 2, instance 3, and instance 4. Now whatever the next incoming request are coming, it will send back to the instance 1, instance 2, instance 3, and instance 4. So in this way it works. Now one major difference that you need to remember again here is with respect to application and load network load balancer. That is, for application load balancer, it requires at least 2 availability zones. That is, while creating a load balancer, the application load balancer requires 2 availability zones, which means your data should be in 2 different availability zones. Though if you are having 2 EC2 instances and both the EC2 instances are a single availability zone, then again you need to create a load balancer with 2 availability zones. Whereas a network load balancer, you don't have such kind of restriction. Even with a single availability zone, you can do. So these are the few points that you need to remember. Okay, any question down in the load balancer part?
Yeah. Is there a restriction on how many instances can be there for a load balancer?
Basically, there is no restriction of how many load balancer, how many EC2 instances you can connect attached to a load balancer. But there is limitation with creating an EC2 instance. Whenever you create an AWS account, you have a default limit of 20. In a single region, you cannot create more than 20 EC2 instances. If you want to create more than 20 EC2 instances, you need to raise the support and tell the AWS person that I need more EC2 instances, so please increase my limit. Because you have a basic plan, you are running a basic plan, so that's why you have that limitation of limitation. If you go for the commercial one, you don't have that limitation. But the question is, for the application load balancer or any kind of load balancer, do we have any limit to number of EC2 instances? Then the answer is
yeah.
no. You don't have any limitation with adding any number of EC2 instances. You can add as much as possible. You can 50, 100, you can add.
Okay, sure. Thank you.
Okay. So shall we see the practical now? We have already created a EC2 instance to different.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. So in the load balancer section, we have two servers. Okay, the first server messages our hi, this is web server one. And the second server says, hi, this is web server two. So it will be very easy for us to differentiate whenever we trigger the request. So let's go to the load balancer. And the load balance section, you can see there are two options. First is load balancer and second is target group. So we need to create both of these options to perform the load balancing. So to create a load balancer, click on load balancer. And here you can select what kind of load balancer you want to select. You can go with the application, network, or classic. Let's go with the application. And here I can say test demo. And what kind of this load balancer is? Is it internet facing, like requests are coming from the internet or it's coming from the internet? So you can select both of this, any of this. I will go with the internet facing. And here you can select the listener. From which port you want to listen the IP addresses. So I will go with the 80. We are going to hit from the browser. So I will go with the 80. You can add multiple listeners here. In which subnet here I want to create. Now, if I just click on one subnet, as I told you, it requires at least two different AWS availability zone. But if I select only one of this and click on next configure, it throws me error. So I need to select both this availability zone. Though my all the EC2 instances are single availability zone, that is AP South 1A. But still, I need to select two different availability zones. Then configure security group. So here we will create one security group. And I will tell ELP security group. And we will say only 80 port. And it is the requests are coming from the internet, so 00. Then configure routing. So this is a target group. If you remember the next point that I have mentioned you in the load balancer, there are two options. First is load balancer, second is target group. So now we have completed first part. Now we are creating second part. That is, we are creating a target group. A target is required for auto load balancer. Sorry, auto scaling. It is required for auto scaling. For example, what happens? You are creating a unit of services like front end, back end, and database. So here we are creating a unit, a group of EC2 instances which define a single unit, like a front end unit. If you have currently four EC2 instances for your front end, now you will create this, you will create a group and you will add all these four EC2 instances so that a load balancer will act on these four EC2 instances. Whatever the incoming requests are coming, it will send the traffic to these four EC2 instances. Now, in case of auto scaling, if there is a high spike and there is automatically 2, 3, 4 EC2 instances are coming up. So with this target group, whatever the new EC2 instances are coming up, that all becomes a part of this group, which means like whenever ELB is now hitting, whenever the requests are coming to the ELB, now this as this the newly created EC2 is a part of this group, all the requests are coming from the ELB will be sent to this EC2 instance also. So here target group is very important when it comes to auto scaling. So let's give that new target group. Then what kind of target is our EC2 instance? Default health check, it is 84. And the advanced health checking, you can say how many healthy threshold you want. Let's say 2 healthy, 2 unhealthy, time to live 5 seconds, time to live 3 seconds. Interval after every 5 seconds, you can say. Okay, did you get what is the difference? What is mean by our target group? Importance of target group. It is very important for auto scaling part. Whenever a new machine automatically comes up, it becomes a part of a auto scaling. It becomes a part of a target group so that the newly coming incoming request from the ELB will be sent to the newly created EC2 instance directly. You don't need to configure manually.
Yep.
Then register target. So here we have two EC2 instances running. You can select this both the EC2 instances and click on add to register. Now both of these EC2 instances is a part of this target group. Click on next review and create. So currently the status is in provisioning, which means it's registering the both the EC2 instance. In the target group, you can select, you can check whether the EC2 instance are healthy or not. So these are my target, and it says initial currently, which means target registration is in process. It will take few seconds. Let's see. Okay, now yeah, you can see the status is healthy, which means like whatever the port, whatever the path that we have mentioned slash, we haven't specified any path here. So if you remember, we have created index.html file. If I just say index.html file, it will now check to the index.html file. And if that index.html file is, is running, then it will say it's healthy. If I just change it to error.html, let's say change the name. Let's say error.html. So this kind of HTML document we haven't created in our EC2 user. Let's just click on save and save. So within few 10 to 15 seconds, it should be marked as unhealthy. It will take 15 seconds approximately.
Okay.
Okay, here now we can see this is unhealthy.
Yep.
Now, if I just copy this DNS endpoint of the load balancer and try to hit to the browser, it's still showing with some cache. So we need to go to the security group and the health check and change the index.html and make it healthy. So again, it will take 14 to 15 seconds and to mark it healthy. So in the monitoring section, you can monitor all this thing, unhealthy host, unhealthy number of counts you have encountered, healthy target response timeout, everything. Now this is a basic monitoring, so it will be working on 5-minute interval. So the moment you have created this elastic load balancer, after 5 minutes you will get the data. And if I see the target, it says healthy. Now if I hit the browser, it says this is web server one. If I refresh, this is web server two. 1, 2, 1, 2. So it means like our both the EC2 instances are working and it is sending the traffic to each of them. I'm just copying this ELB endpoint and sharing on the browser, on the chat. You can also test on your browser. You will also get the same result. It sends to 1 and 2. Okay. So any question, any doubt in the ELB part?
No, I'm good.
Okay, great. So what I will do, ELB is charging. ELB is basically you get only 120 hours per month. So what I will do, I will just keep it as it is. And I will just shut this EC2 instance because tomorrow we will see auto scaling. So at that time we will require the same path. So I'm just stopping the path here and we have load balancer also running. Let's keep it ready. Okay, please try this, and tomorrow if required then we can have again a session. You can also perform the same on our session during the session time if you want.
Yeah, I just have one question. So you said that we can only attach volume to the instance if it is in the same availability zone, right?
Correct.
So if we try to attach to a different zone, will it error out?
No, basically what will happen, like I have one volume, okay? Mm. Just 10 GB of volume. If I click on attach, currently it is detached. I need to detach first. Okay, so basically let's just create one GB of volume I create. And this is created in availability zone. This is created in availability zone 1A. Okay.
Mm.
Now, if I click on action, let's just it come. It's creating still. Okay. So if I just click on action and attach, so I will get a list of EC2 instances in AP South 1A only. If there is an EC2 instance in AP South 1B, then it will not show me here.
Okay. Yeah, I got it.
Okay. So this is very important to it will not show you EC2 instance from another availability zone.
Okay.
And very important to remember, once you are done with the lab session, make sure you delete both the volumes or whatever the volumes you are creating, because you get only 30 GB volume for 1 month, I guess. So make sure you use it wisely. Okay.
Yeah, sure.
Thanks. Okay then. See you tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Yeah,
bye. We will have a session on Monday or Tuesday directly. For the weekend, we don't have session. Okay?
Okay, so tomorrow we don't have it?
Yeah, we don't have it. But okay, if there is any changes in it, I will let Archana to know you.
Sure. Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Thanks. Bye-bye.